Hi everyone. Today I'm with my friend David again. David Gozard runs his own YouTube channel, which I'll link down below. And we thought today we would like to talk to you about some of the books we recommend for learning physics. So this is a question I've had reasonably often, which is how do I either go from nothing to knowing something about physics, and how do I find books to do that? So I thought, David, having done physics yourself and now you're working in physics, you'd have a good perspective on that.
Yeah, so I thought a good one to start off with for these would be for those of you who are looking at this recreationally, or you want to get the very first idea of what's involved in a certain topic. And for those, I can recommend a series of books called Very Short Introductions. You can get a very short introduction to nuclear physics, a very short introduction to particle physics or quantum mechanics. And they do those for lots of different subjects. You can get a very short introduction to business management and Islam and anything, any sort of studies you want. They have over 400 of these books. They're very, very small. You can read them in a few hours. You can pick them up for about $13. If you get the Kindle version, they're as little as $7 or $9. Mm. So they don't give you any of the maths of the physics, but they give you a very brief overview of the concepts, where the science is today. So if you're doing cosmology, it'll talk about Big Bang, nuclear synthesis, evolution of the universe, how we got to where we are
today. So those
today
are for people that are sort of, they don't know any physics at the moment. Like, it's not any required background knowledge.
Yeah, if you don't have any background in physics yet, these are good books to get you started or get you interested, or just for recreational reading.
I'll make sure like everything we're about to say is linked down below, like in the description, and I'll maybe put like little pictures of the covers. So what else do you think is good for total beginners in a way?
For total beginners, I know you're a fan of Marcus Chown. I'm a fan of Marcus Chown too.
That's one of my favorites. So I guess in high school is when I started reading Marcus Chown books, and he writes popular science or popular physics books, and I thought you didn't really need any background in physics to understand them, but they were really interesting. So one in particular, which was recommended to me by a friend in high school, was We Need to Talk About Kelvin, and it's got like really good descriptions of like stellar nucleosynthesis and how stars work and just how astronomy works in a way. I found that really interesting.
Yeah, I've read several of Marcus Chown's books. They're all really, really good. There's a reason he's one of the most popular science writers.
I was actually lucky enough to meet Marcus Chown one day back in New Zealand.
Really?
So I got a little photo with him. One of my other favorite like pop science writers that I read in high school was this book, The Edge of Physics, by the author Anil Anaswani, something like that. I'll put a picture of it. But it was all about...
I have heard of the guy. I know he's good. I haven't read this one, but I know the guy's good.
Well, The Edge of Physics was all about introducing you to things like these big neutrino telescopes, which they have in Antarctica, as well as like in old abandoned gold mines. It's like science experiments, but on the edge of science, like really awesome setups and things you're like, wow, I didn't know that existed.
Sounds good. I want to read that one. What else? So we've got basically Richard Feynman. So Richard Feynman, for those of you who don't know him, he's generally regarded as one of the greatest physicists of all time. He's probably in every physicist's top five, top ten list. He's famous for being able to explain physics concepts and very difficult physics concepts in very accessible ways. And so he's got several books. There's QED by Richard Feynman, which is about quantum electrodynamics, which is his field that he won the Nobel Prize for. But the famous thing is the Feynman Lectures on Physics. Now, there's the Feynman Lectures on Physics are a bit funny. They are in some regards some of the best lectures on physics ever, and in some regards some of the worst. Because Feynman had always previously taught postgraduate physicists, and he was asked to give first and second year lectures. And it turned out that more postgrads and more professors turned out to these lectures than the actual undergraduates he was meant to be lecturing. And he even says in the introduction to these lectures, in the published version, that he realizes he didn't quite hit the mark with these. That if you're trying to pass an exam, these are not good lectures. But if you're just want, if you just want to learn about the physics, learn about the concepts, they are very good.
I think Feynman is a really good communicator. So whilst I've never used the Feynman lectures to study for something, I have read them out of interest, and they're actually what I would now go to understand deeply a concept, not just to be able to do the equations on the exam. Because I don't think there's a lot of math really in these Feynman lectures. It's very conceptual, and yeah, he was one of those guys that can just write on the whiteboard and take you on a journey through the ideas.
Yeah, so a lot of my lecturers based their lectures on the Feynman lectures, but then did it in a different way. So they would use Feynman to work out what concepts and what important things you need to get across, but then they would do it a different way so that I could learn the maths and pass the exam.
Yeah.
So for people who are looking to get into this as a first step, so reading for recreation, or you're a high school student wondering what a future holds in physics if you continue studying physics, Feynman's really, really good. And even at an undergraduate level, because these deficiencies in the Feynman lectures have been recognized, you can get course readers to go along with the Feynman lectures. So you can read the lecture and then go and do problem sets.
Yeah.
And so overall, I think that balances out.
I don't remember if we said, but like the Feynman lectures are all available online as well as like
are
in
they?
Books. Yeah, I think Caltech put them all online in written form. There's also like you said, some companion readers online. But yeah, you can find links to those ones. Yeah. Feynman also has like other books as well, like Surely You're Joking, Mr. Feynman, and he has a few books on like problem solving. Those are not necessarily to learn physics, but you might find them interesting too.
They're great stories, but there's not a lot of physics in Surely You're Joking, Mr. Feynman. You wanted to mention Michio Kaku. Now, I haven't read any Michio Kaku. I've seen his TV stuff.
Yeah, well, to be honest, I've seen more of Michio's like TV stuff than I have his books, but I remember one of the books I had in high school of his was Parallel Worlds. And again, I don't think you're really learning physics from this, but it's like a really awesome overview of like cosmology and the future of the universe in a way. It's quite grand scale. It was an interesting book.
Okay.
Now let's talk about this nice stack of textbooks we have.
Yep.
Some of our faves from undergrad.
Now the fun stuff. So for undergraduate, my textbook in undergraduate was Fundamentals of Physics by Halliday, Resnick and Walker. What was yours?
So my first year physics textbook was by Serway and Jewett, and it was Physics for Scientists and Engineers. Now, I think it was an okay book. It was for like engineers as well. It was quite applied, but it took you through everything you needed to know to pass first year physics. I thought it was fine.
I went back to my first year one in later years, and the Halliday Resnick Walker one was written really well. It's on its millionth edition. My mum used it back when she was studying at university, so it's gone through. It's been used again and again and again, updated year after year. I think it's very, very good. The explanations and the maths and the worked problems in it, but so many of these are good. There's Giancoli as well.
Okay, yeah. I really think that any introductory or first year uni textbook on calculus or physics, it's going to be pretty much the same. There's only so many ways you can talk about the fundamental physics concepts like mechanics, a little bit of modern physics, thermodynamics. There's only so many ways you can introduce those topics. So I think just pick up any first year textbook, you should be fine. I think actually my Serway and Jewett textbook was the only one I actually bought in university. I was like, oh, I'm at uni, I need to buy the textbooks. I bought it for the first semester, and then after that I would download the PDF or just get it out from the library. So it's not necessary to buy all these textbooks. There's other ways to get them.
Okay. So moving on beyond first year, second year, third year, you're learning special relativity, quantum mechanics, more complex atomic physics. For me, this was my Bible. This is Modern Physics by Tipler and Llewellyn. There are lots of books called Modern Physics. You can find books called Modern Physics from 100 years ago. It's not the best title, but for some reason they persist with it. But this was really, really good. It covers all those sorts of things from relativity to cosmology, wave-like properties of particles, Schrodinger equation, quantum mechanics, molecular structures.
I think anything that's not Newton mechanics is classed modern physics, is
yeah,
that right?
Pretty much. It's a, like postmodern sort of thing. Just anything, when's that, 1920s? Postmodern. The worked examples in this are really, really good. So even if you're actually a recreational reader and you want to learn how to calculate that E equals MC squared, or you want to understand the Schrodinger equation on a sort of mathematical level, this is actually pretty good. It leads you slowly and methodically through those calculations. And so I would come back to this book year after year to relearn the stuff I'd forgotten or get the first bits, even later courses like in honours. I would go to this to get the first bits of the course and then build on it from there. So I highly recommend this book. It was wonderful. It got me through my undergrad.
Good to know. All right, thanks for that one. I can see the next one on this list is one of my ones. This is Charles Cattell, and this is Introduction to Solid State Physics. Now, Cattell also has a book, which is, I think, an introduction to thermal physics, and both of those I found really good. Now, in a way, I think when you're at university, the best textbook to be getting and reading is the one that you think your lecturer is reading and taking the problems from for the exam, in which case for most exams on solid state physics I've ever done, the questions have come from this book, Cattell. So I just found it to be really easy to understand, to read. The problems were easy to do, and the problems often showed up in assignments and exams. So I would recommend anything by Cattell.
I haven't read Cattell, but it sounds good. Right, now we're on to David Griffiths. So Toby and I are both fans of David Griffiths. We both have heard from other people who really don't like David Griffiths, but Toby and I did our degrees in different countries. We're both huge fans of David Griffiths. I had David Griffiths books assigned as course readers in undergrad. Most of the people I went through physics with really, really like him. There are some people who don't. I think they're crazy, because David Griffiths is a really, really good writer of textbooks. So we've got a couple of his here. So the one on top just happens to be Introduction to Elementary Particles. So quarks and gluons and things and all that, subatomic physics. It's DJ Griffiths. He's a really, really good writer. My undergraduate courses were basically built around these books. I learned a lot. They're very, very clear. You can follow through the exercises and the maths very, very easily. I think DJ Griffiths is really, really good. So here we've got Introduction to Elementary Particles. We've also got his Introduction to Electrodynamics, which I think is considered one of the greatest physics textbooks of all time.
Yeah, this we're going to talk about this one later. This is like a postgrad electrodynamics book. When I was doing this course, I had to check out that book as well just to decipher what was in here. Yep. So that one saved me a few times. My favourite Griffiths book is his Introduction to Quantum Mechanics. It's just the cutest book. It's got this cover with a cat alive on one side and dead on the back. And I would just always want to have that book checked out with me, because it was just, if I had a problem in quantum mechanics, I don't know, I thought that that book could answer it for me, at least in the undergrad sense. Like, I've heard the criticism of that particular intro to quantum that it doesn't cover anything, you know, higher level or postgrad level quantum, but you don't need that when you're doing undergrad. So I thought it was fine.
Yeah, so for quantum mechanics, electrodynamics, and subatomic physics, particle physics, DJ Griffiths books, we highly recommend. He's also got another book, which is called, where have I written it? Revolutions in 20th Century Physics. Now, I haven't read that one, but I've had a quick flip through it, and it seems to be very similar to my Modern Physics by Tipler and Llewellyn. So it covers relativity and atomic physics and wave particle duality and things like that at a slightly lower level. So again, it's probably good if you're looking to first get into those sort of sciences, or if you're looking for a Bible that will get you through your undergrad. It seems like Griffith's Revolutions in 20th Century Physics is a very good book.
Good author, so we agree on that one.
I've had it recommended to me by others, but I haven't read that one specifically.
All right, so were there any more undergrad books that you had on your little list?
Nope. So we've gone through all the undergrad ones. Okay. Now we're on to the postgrad.
So, okay, I mentioned this one earlier. This was my number one most hated book. But I, see, I did a course. This was during my honours year in physics. And we did, like, electromag. And it was just, I found this particular book quite hard to understand. We did use it as part of the course. So our assignment questions were questions from here. But I personally found this book really hard to read. I don't know what your thoughts are.
I had that same book assigned as well. If talking to other physicists, looking around online, It is generally considered the best postgraduate electrodynamics textbook.
I think the ideas it covers are like the most advanced, I think, than the other textbooks, and that's why it has that reputation, because it's like it's a lot more advanced than the other electromagnetics.
But like you, I needed to go back to Griffiths to then springboard me into that so I could do that. Yeah. And again, there are to help you with that, there are course readers and worked problem sets and all sorts of other resources.
Oh yeah, there's lots of worked problems online, which is helpful when you're doing
this. So in terms of passing exams, we highly recommend this book. In terms of wanting to read it,
definitely
I never want to touch
book.
It ever again.
Yeah, no.
Okay. Right, so the weird stuff, things like quantum gravity, string theory. For quantum gravity, I'm not sure about recommending this. This is Quantum Gravity by Carlo Rovelli. Carlo Rovelli is a theorist who specializes in loop quantum gravity. He writes beautifully. His maths and his language is really easy to follow. He writes absolutely beautifully. He even throws in sort of bits of other art and culture. He's a very wide-read guy, so there'll be references to Hamlet and other things in this book. It really is fantastic. The problem with recommending Carlo Rovelli is I'm not a theorist, I'm an experimentalist. So talking to the theorists I know, they're not so big fans of his, because he is loop quantum gravity. And when I was doing my undergrad, I thought loop quantum gravity was sort of not really taken seriously anymore, that it was started dying about 20 years ago. Rovelli's still working in that field. If you read his stuff, then you start coming around to the loop quantum gravity way of thinking, and you start to think, this is a serious contender, this is really, really good, there's a lot of potential here. While the theorists I talked to back at my old institution would say, no.
Okay.
So for quantum gravity, this is brilliantly written, easy to follow. Whether it will take you further than postgraduate, not sure.
Okay.
String theory is one we had a problem with.
I guess I didn't have a good book to recommend for this one.
I didn't have a good book to recommend for this one either. I asked friends for recommendations who knew more about string theory than I did, and the recommendation was that there is no good textbook for string theory. I was told there's one good one, but you need to go and get a separate differential geometry textbook in order to be able to go to the differential geometry one, learn from that, and then come back to
and
the string theory.
And differential geometry is not easy. So
basically, if you're looking at string theory at the postgraduate level, you don't need our help in picking a book.
If you have a good book, let us know.
Yes, please.
So I guess those are some of the textbooks. Those are what we think are good and what have helped us get to where we are. I would say, like, as we're wrapping up, if you are, like, trying to learn some physics, teach yourself physics, go to books, but also don't discount online resources, whether you're starting at something like Khan Academy to just get the first skills, all the way up to like, there are Feynman lectures online, like recordings, there are all sorts of things on YouTube as well that you can actually learn a lot of good physics from.
Yeah, MIT and Caltech and a lot of other universities put their courses online. There's a theoretical physicist, Gerard T. Hooft, who has started compiling online a list of free online resources for people who want to get into physics. So he's put it out in special relativity, general relativity, string theory, things like that. The list isn't complete yet. Some of it, like, you click on string theory and supergravity and it's just three dots, it's just empty, because he hasn't finished compiling it yet, but they're all online free resources that he recommends for you to go and learn about these things. So there are more than buying expensive books.
Yeah. And also, I think with this advice, if you want to learn more physics, just read the books and consume the content that you actually enjoy reading and learning about. Don't force yourself to sit through a textbook you find really, really awful unless you need to for a course. Just do any sort of learning that you enjoy. All right, I think that's all our advice. Thanks, David.
Thanks for having me.
And thanks for watching.